Hello and welcome! This is an overview after day 2 of Victoria 2 multiplayer game. And first of all, I wish you Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. So, before I start talking about this game, I have to mention that we are continuing probably this one or starting a new game on ParadoxPlaza TeamSpeak server. So that is today 5 PM GMT. Today is, of course, the Sunday. So I hope that we are going to continue this game, but that might not happen because we might have many new players. We'll see though. And then one more thing I have to talk about before we start a review is that we are having a special multiplayer game on 4th of January. That is a Saturday, I think. And we should start around 4 or 5 PM GMT time. So the game is special because A, it has different rules. B, well, different rules meaning that you're allowed to use containment casus belli or casus belli on anyone, so not only on AI. Few minor differences also in rules, and then game will be rated. So I've been working with few friends on the rated games project, or we have a new forum for the rated games, and I think we're pretty much ready for it. We still have to do with a few balances, but hopefully that will be done once the game starts. So that's pretty much it. If you wish to join that game, you will have to sign on the forum. This is so we can determine rating and that we can be sure that players aren't switching countries every session. So that's basically it. And let's start a review. We of course have Asun playing Mexico. I'm gonna close this so you can see better. And we have, I think Daniel played CSA. He initially played Japan. Now he has switched. So as you can see, Mexico and CSA are both in a war against USA. And let me show you that war. It's actually Confederate Liberation of Missouri. It's France, Mexico, Scandinavia, CSA, UK and Italy against USA. So USA is pretty much screwed. As you can see, they're a great power at the moment and they will drop very soon. So bye bye USA. We'll have probably a decent sized CSA. Let's see how that works out. If you wish to join this game, Canada might not be a bad choice. As you can see, no one actually attacked them, and they have a decent industrial power. It's still not that late in the game. It's 1874, so colonization is over, but still, you can do pretty well with American countries. In the South America, we have Brazil being played by Jules. For a few years, he didn't play whole session with Brazil, I think. So he did retake his core possession from Bolivia and actually has acquired a few territories from them as well. Colombia was played by, I really can't remember all the names because people started changing countries during the session, so I'm not sure. Anyway, as you can see, Colombia took a part of Venezuela and is doing pretty well. Unfortunately, it's unlikely that we're going to see Gran Colombia formed, which should be this part, due to Colombia having to become a great power before forming it. So let's move to Asia. Here we had Japan being played by Daniel in the beginning, quite unplayable, to be honest. They lost civilization process 3 times and have an 88 infamy at the moment. They have been contained, I think, by, I think it was UK or maybe some other AI great power. I'm not completely sure. Then again, Korea can actually be played. It's still a non-civilized nation. Let's check their civilization process. They're at 40%, so they'll be quite behind in researches and technologies, so I'm not sure. Anyway, we had Scandinavia in this session getting one more territory from China, that is Shaanxi. So they have a best coal province in the world. I think it's the best. It probably is. Let me check RGO output. Yeah, it is definitely. So, Scandinavia in pretty good shape here. Serbia, of course, gaining, that was played by me. Yeah, Scandinavia was played by Christian. So Serbia gaining two more territories from China, nothing too serious. And then we had Holland or Netherlands expanding in Asia, of course taking all the islands and finishing up with colonization of Borneo. Spain is doing pretty much nothing, getting rebellions all over the place. And those are actually Philippine nationalists. So we might have a Spain losing those islands actually sometime soon. That will be interesting. So in Siam there was Britain expansion, as you can see. They now possess Nakhon Ruchisma and Laos, I think. Yeah, British Laos. So FTC playing India. They can pretty much all of Afghanistan. I think he didn't take anything from Persia. Yeah, he took Kalat and what is Makran, right? Yep, Makran. And then expanded a bit on China, getting Tibet. And this is Xinjiang. So India is huge. They're third great power, so India will be a huge deal in this game. And of course taking few Shan states, so India will control pretty much all the oil in the world once it spawns. So we'll see about that. And let's move to Africa, the most interesting part here. What's happened? And Germany actually formed by rebels. So there was an AI playing Germany, not a human player. And as you can see, they actually managed to get something from Africa. Really not the richest parts, but still. As you can see, let me just hide battle plans from UK. UK actually wanted to grab this part of Africa, but they didn't manage due to France stopping them in the east, and then Germany from the north. So they still got some decent parts in Africa. As you can see, British Ghana, and I think Sierra Leone is also taken by them. Well, decent parts. They could have done better, but still, not too bad. France, of course, did the best in colonization. They had the most colonial power, and they certainly used it, so they have huge chunk in Africa. And as you can see, Mexico actually did pretty well in their colonization. They got some really rich provinces in Africa, mainly Niger Delta and the Congo region also. So as you can see, Portuguese are completely raped in Africa. They only have one colonial province, that is Eastern Africa. And actually, they have Moroccan province. That is only one, and really nothing huge. So Mexico, France and Britain gained most from Africa. As you can see, Italy did take something, but really those are worthless provinces. As you can see, they fought a war against Ottomans, took two provinces from them, and took some province from Egypt. However, those are all desert regions and are really not worth taking infamy for it. So there is that. Egypt actually still exists, although they only have three territories. We'll see if they will remain to exist for much longer. Kinda interesting though. And let's move to Europe finally. Oh, actually I forgot to mention Scandinavia, if I didn't mention, was played by Christian, and UK played by Marconi. So Scandinavia did take Zulu and Transvaal regions from Africa, but those weren't a colonial provinces, but rather state provinces, I think. Although Zulu is a colonial province, Transvaal isn't. So anyway, let's switch to Europe. As you can see, France, played by Guren, continued their expansion on Spain, taking Valencia and Granada. So Spain is completely doomed. If you plan on joining the game, you shouldn't really join Spain. They have nothing to do in Europe anymore. As you can see, they have a population of 2.6 million, so that is really, really bad. UK played more of an AFK game. They actually, we can say they've won a war against France and France, Russia, Scandinavia, and who was in that war? Italy? Maybe Italy. So British Navy obliterated France and Russian Navy. Also Prussia did have some ships, but not too many. So the coalition wasn't able to transport their troops to Africa, so Britain just occupied all of the French provinces in Africa, so they had to peace out, getting a wide peace to UK, which is actually pretty good deal for them. And then we had, of course, Italy being formed. That happened in the end of the previous session, I think. But then the Italian player changed, so we had a sudden change of tides. At first they got Venice and Istria from Austria, and then we asked to join the war. We joined and get Dalmatia on our own, so we had an agreement with Italy that they let us take Dalmatia so we can form Yugoslavia and coexist. And then the huge deal, and the first, I don't know if I can call this a great war because there was only one great power on one side, but well, anyway, the story begins with Russian occupation of Bulgaria. So if you don't know, Bulgaria is considered a part of Yugoslavia. It's not a core part, so you can still form Yugoslavia without it, but you can form it with it. And if you form it without it, I think you don't have course on Bulgaria anymore. So this is because of Bulgaria, of course, being a Slav state, so you can include them in Yugoslavia. Anyway, so Russia first expanded on Constanza and took Kars province from Ottoman Empire, and at that point I was fine with that, because as you can see, Constanza and or Dobruja is actually considered as a Romanian core. So if I'd form Yugoslavia with it, then I would have problems with Romania wanting independence and declaring wars on me. So, you know, sacrificing that region for the peace on Balkans would be a quite decent choice, I think. So I was quite fine with that, but then the problem was that Russia decided to sphere Hungary and Austria. And I had to, at that point, I didn't have Vojvodina, which is this region. It says Slavonia here, but it's not. Slavonia is this part here. Anyway, I didn't have Vojvodina and Croatia, which I needed to form Yugoslavia, of course. And that meant that I had to go in a war against Hungary. So I asked Russia if they would interfere in the war, and they said that they would. So I had to seek for an alliance, and I asked Britain. Britain agreed, but they wouldn't really help in the war. They would just stay AFK. So I had to seek for further alliances. What better alliance than, well, what better ally than France, right? So we formed an alliance with France and declared war on Hungary. France didn't join in the beginning because we were still hoping that Russia in the end wouldn't join the war, but that unlikely, unfortunately, that did happen. So Britain and me were in the war in the beginning, and I was letting Hungary actually win a war in the beginning. So they would add a war goal, and then Russia would be unable to join the war. By that time, Hungary was actually kicked from the Russian sphere by France, so Russia wasn't protecting them. That way they could only join the war once the war score was on our side. And so the war began. Unfortunately, Russia had just, I think once they mobilized, they had almost 300 brigades, which is a crap ton of soldiers, and I couldn't really fight with them. So I had to retreat and wait till the French and Italian armies join us. And then a huge battle happened in, I believe it was in Sinj, or maybe in Karlovac, I'm not completely sure. So Russian armies lost a huge battle there. It was like 400 stack against 200 stack or something like that. And French and Italian troops, with a small help from us, managed to get a huge victory. And in the end, we got a peace deal from Russia, getting Slavonia, Croatia, and Britain actually added a war goal on liberating Bulgaria, which by that time was actually occupied fully by Russia, so Bulgaria is completely free at the moment, which is great. And that means that in next session we have to get East Macedonia, Ottoman Montenegro, and of course Slovenia from Austria. We might make Bulgaria a puppet, so they will become Yugoslavia once we form it. But we'll see how that works out.